So let us talk about this cyclomatic complexity. This cyclomatic complexity is a software metric. This is used for something called measurement. So software, you need to measure something. For that, this cyclomatic complexity is, and I'll tell you what it is measuring. So it was developed by Thomas McCabe in 1976 and is used to indicate the complexity of a program. That is why it is named as cyclomatic complexity. It directly measures the number of linearly independent paths through a programmer source code. So if source code is there, cyclomatic complexity directly tells you that how many linearly independent paths are there. So the concept, although not the method, is somewhat similar to that of general text complexity measured by this Flesch-Hinkett readability test. Cyclomatic complexity is computed using the control flow graph of the program. For that, you need to draw a graph. The nodes of the graph, which is this corresponds to indivisible group of commands of a program, and a directed edge. Directed edge, this connects two nodes. So you have node and this is the edge. So directed edge connects two nodes if the second command might be executed immediately after the first command. And cyclomatic complexity may also be applied to individual functions, modules, methods or classes within a program. So not only for complete source code, this is also useful for the sub part of a program. So this is basis path testing. So one testing strategy, which is called the basis path testing, which by McCabe, who first proposed it, is to test each linearly independent path through the program. So in this case, this is an example, the number of test cases will equal to the cyclomatic complexity of the program. So ultimately, what I should tell you is this cyclomatic complexity compute or tells you how many test cases you should have. Okay, test cases it automatically generates the number of test cases you should have. So control flow graph of a simple program will describe. The program begins executing at red node, this red node, and then enters a loop. It enters a loop. Okay, and group of three nodes immediately below the red node, and on exiting the loop there is a conditional statement. Okay, there is a conditional statement, again conditional statement, and finally the program exits at the blue node. It ends at the blue node. So for this graph we have edges 9 and this nodes 8 and p equal to 1. So that cyclomatic complexity of the program is 3, right? We have these at the edges, compute this, calculate edges and nodes, and this p equal to 1, right? So the cyclomatic complexity of the program is 3. So the cyclomatic complexity of a section of a source code is the count of the number of linearly independent paths through the source code. Let me add here one more thing. This is E minus N plus 2. The formula is this, right? 9 minus 8 plus 2. So 9 minus 8 is what? 1. 1 plus 2 is 3. That is why this is the number. This is actually the number of, this is the cyclomatic complexity of the program. This is the formula. Please remember it. Now we were talking about linearly independent path through source code. For instance, if the source code contain no decision points such as if or for loop, the complexity would be just 1, since there is only a single path through the code. If the code had a single if statement containing a single condition, there would be 2 paths through the code. One path where the if statement is evaluated as true, and one path where the if statement is evaluated as false. Right? So mathematically, the cyclomatic complexity of a structured program is actually defined with a reference to a directed graph. This is a directed graph containing the basic blocks of the program. With an edge between two basic blocks, if controls may pass from first to the second. The control graph, flow graph of the program is this. The complexity of is then defined as m is equal to e minus n plus 2p. N is the cyclomatic complexity, e is the number of edges, n is the number of nodes of the graph, and p is the number of connected components. Right? So generally we take p as 1, that is why we say it as e minus n plus 2p. P is the number of connected components. So the same function as above, as we have seen, show a strongly connected control flow graph for calculation via the alternating method. E is 10, N is 8, P is 1, so the complexity is 3. So an alternative formulation is to use a graph in which each exit point is connected back to the entry point. So in this case, the graph is said to be strongly connected. The cyclomatic complexity of the program is now equal to the cyclomatic number of its graph, also known as the first Betti number, which is defined as this. Okay, this I told you. This is what we started, and I, you know, tried to, you know, tell you how we have achieved or this expression we have come across as far as cyclomatic complexity is concerned. So this may be seen as calculating the number of linearly independent cycles that exist in the graph, that is those cycles that do not contain other cycles within themselves. Note that because each exit point loop back to the entry point, there is at least one such cycle for each exit point. Okay, for a single program, P is always equal to 1 or a subroutine of method. That is why we take P always as 1. A cyclomatic complexity may, however, be applied to several such programs or subprograms at the same time, that is to all of the methods in a class. In these cases, P will be equal to the number of programs in question, as each subprogram will appear as a disconnected subset of the graph. So we were talking about just one, that is why we took P as 1. If we have number of subprograms, then we have to use that number of P's. So it can be shown that cyclomatic complexity of any structured program with only one entrance point and one exit point is equal to the number of decision points, that is if statement or conditional loops containing that program plus one. So cyclomatic complexity may be extended to a program with multiple exit points also. In this case, it will be equal to pi minus s plus 2. This pi is nothing but the number of decision points in the program, and this s is the number of exit points, right? Pi is decision points, s is the exit point. So formally, let us give the definition. Formally, cyclomatic complexity can be defined as a relative Betti number, the size of the relative homology group. This m is equal to b1 Betti, g, comma t, and rank of h1 gt, which is read as the first homology of the graph g relative to the terminal nodes t. So this is a technical way of saying that the number of linearly independent paths through the flow graph from an entry to an exit. Right, so linearly independent correspond to the homology and means one does not double count backtracking. And path corresponding to the first homology, a path is of one dimensional object. Relative means the path must begin and end at a single entry and exit. So this corresponds to the intuitive notion of cyclomatic complexity calculated as what we have calculated above. Alternatively, we can compute this via absolute Betti number, absolute homology not relative, by identifying all terminal nodes on a given component, or equivalently draw path connecting to the exit to the entrance, in which case we obtain, this is calling the new augmented graph, which is m is equal to b1g and drive h1g. So this corresponding to the characterization of cyclomatic complexity as number of loops plus number of components. Now coming to this etymology or naming, because the naming is somewhat complex. This name cyclomatic complexity may at first seem confusing, but it is very easy as this metric does not only count cycles in the program. Okay, it is very, because this metric only not count cycles, but it is motivated by the number of different cycles in the program control flow graph. After having added n, imagine branch back from the exit node to the entry node. The various applications limiting complexity during development, implications for software testing, cohesion, correlation to number of defects. So let us start with this limiting complexity during development. One of the McAfee's original application was to limit the complexity of routine during program development. So he recommended that programmers should count the complexity of the module they are developing and split them smaller modules whenever the cyclomatic complexity of the module exceeds 10. Right? This is what he wanted to limit the complexity. So this practice was adopted by the NIST structure testing methodology with an observation that since McAfee's original publication, the figure of 10 has received substantial corroborating evidence, but that is some circumstances it may be appropriate to relax the restriction and permit modules with a complexity as high as 50 for various reasons. And as this methodology acknowledged that there were occasional reasons for going beyond agreed upon limit, this or 10, it phrased its recommendation as for each module, either limit cyclomatic complexity, that is the agreed upon limit, or provide a written explanation of why the limit was exceeded. An implication for software testing. Another application of this cyclomatic complexity is in determining the number of test cases that are necessary to achieve thorough or through test coverage of a particular module. So it is useful because two properties of the cyclomatic complexity, this for a specific module M is a upper bound for the number of test cases that are necessary to achieve a complete branch coverage, and N is the lower bound for the number of paths through the control flow graph, CFG. So assuming each test case takes one path, the number of cases needed to achieve path coverage is equal to the number of paths that can actually be taken. But some path may be impossible. So although the number of paths through this CFG control flow graph is clearly an upper bound on the number of test cases needed for this path coverage, this latter number, that is a possible path, is sometimes less than this N. So all three of the upper numbers may be equal: branch coverage, cyclomatic complexity, the number of path. For example, consider a program that consists of two sequential if-then-else. If, then else, right? So we have sequential if-then-else command. This is one, this is two. So the control flow graph, this is for first if, this is a second if. The control flow graph of the source code above, the red circle is the entry point for the function and the blue is the exit. The exit has been connected to the entry to make the graph strongly connected. So in this example, this is why we have connected this to strongly connected. In this example, two test cases are sufficient to achieve a complete branch coverage, while four are necessary for complete path coverage. And the cyclomatic complexity of this program is 3, as the strongly connected graph for the program contains 9 edges, 7 nodes and 1 connected component. Right? So this is how 9 minus 7 plus 1. So it becomes 3. So in general, in order to fully test a module, all execution path through the module should be exercised. This implies a module with a higher complexity number requires more testing effort than a module with a lower value, since the higher complexity number indicates more pathways through the code. This also implies that a module with higher complexity is more difficult for a programmer to understand, since the programmer must understand the different pathways and the result of those pathways. Unfortunately, it's not always practical to test all possible paths through the program. So considering the example above, which each time an additional if-then-else statement is added, the number of possible path doubles itself. So as the program given this fashion, it could quickly reach the point where testing all of the paths are impractical. So one common testing strategy espoused, for example, by the NIST structure testing methodology is to use this cyclomatic complexity of a module to determine the number of white box tests that are required to obtain sufficient coverage of the module. So in almost all cases, according to such a methodology, a module should have at least as many tests as the cyclomatic complexity. So in most cases, this number of tests is adequate to exercise all the relevant paths of the function. So as an example of a function that requires more than simply branch coverage to the test accurately, consider again the above function, which we just told you, 2f if then else. But assume that to avoid a bug occurring, any code that calls either F1 or F3 must also call the other. So assuming that the result of this C1 and C2 are independent, that means that the function is presented above contains a bug. So branch coverage would allow us to test the method with just two cases, and one possible set of tests would be to test the following cases: C1 returns true, C2 returns true, C1 returns false, C2 returns false. So neither of these cases exposes any bug. So if, however, we use cyclomatic complexity to indicate the number of tests we require, the number increases to 3. So we must therefore test one of the following paths: C1 returns true and C2 returns false, and C1 returns false and C2 returns true. Either of these tests will expose your bug. Now coming to cohesion, one would also expect that a module with higher complexity would tend to have lower cohesion, less than functional cohesion, than a module with lower complexity. So the possible correlation between higher complexity measured with a lower level of cohesion is predicted on a module with more decision points generated implementing more than a single well-defined functions. So a 2005 study showed stronger correlation between complexity metrics and an expert assessment of cohesion in the classes studied than the correlation between the expert's assessment and metric designated to calculate cohesion. Now coming to correlation to number of defects, a number of studies have investigated cyclomatic complexity correlation to the number of defects containing the model. Number of defects. So most such studies find a strong positive correlation between this cyclomatic complexity and defects. So modules that have the highest complexity tend to also contain most defects. For example, in 2008, study of metric monitoring software supply energy analyzed classes of open source Java application and divided them into two sets based on how commonly faults were found in them. They found strong correlation between the cyclomatic complexity and the faultiness, with classes with a combined complexity of 11 having a probability of being fault prone to just 0.25, rising to 0.98 for a class with a complexity of 74. However, the studies that controls for program size, you know, modules that have different complexities but similar size, typically measured in line of code are generally less conclusive, with many findings no significant correlation, while others do find correlation. So some researchers who have studied the area questions the validity of the method used by the studies, finding no correlation. Less had claimed recently that McCabe's cyclomatic complexity has the same prediction ability as the line of code. So this was all about your cyclomatic complexity. Thank you so much. Take care.